us direction from above. We need a word from the Lord. A word from the Lord. Just one word from the Lord will move all the doubts.
Good morning, Best Grove. I thank you for watching this morning and for being with us as you have on so many other occasions. And to our community, thank you for your continued love and support and all that you continue to do to live your lives for the utmost of God's kingdom. And we redoing this sermon from earlier this morning. There were too many technical difficulties, so I ask you to pray with me as I continue to try to improve and give my utmost for his eyes. Would you pray with me this morning? Eternal God, we come to you this morning thanking you for all that you continue to do in our lives. How you blessed us and strengthened us. How you protected us and watched over us all night long. We've seen an unseen danger, you've kept us. We thank you, God, because we have a fresh start to live better than we lived yesterday. This morning we come to you with scars, we come to you with issues, we come to you with the battles that we've been engaged in, psychologically, spiritually, mentally, and physically. It's been rough, God, but we tried to hold up the bloodstained banner. We tried to do what you wanted us to do. We yielded to your spirit. That meant that the devil brought out everything in his war chest against us. Every lie he could tell, every mistruth, his unscrupulous ways that try to destroy friendships, break up homes, and treat us everything except like a child of God. But something on the inside would not allow him to have his way with us. And we just thank you right now, God, for it. And we just ask your blessings. We pray for the hearers of this word today. We pray that it will unlock some mystery of yours, of truth, that will give them strength and courage, that will set them free, that will endow them to be closer to you and closer to one another. When we learn how to love you, learn how to be loved by you, we can certainly love everybody else. The world is not some raggedy place as we think it is, because the closer we get to you, the more the light of yours can pierce the darkness. The darkness of racism and hatred, the darkness of injustice, the darkness of all the phobias that are out there. Because greater is he that is in us than he that is in the world. Thank you for it, God. I'm praying, God, as we enter this word today, that you remind us that we're in the danger zone. A place where there is death, where there is the possibility of harm and hurt. But let us to remind us that we're never alone, that we go through every step of it. A place that's unfamiliar to us, but it's a place of learning and teaching. So watch over us there, God. And open our ears and our hearts. Open us up spiritually that we can discern your truth. Now may the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, my Lord, my strength, and my Redeemer. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Well, good morning to you, Best Grove, and I thank you for worshiping with us again today. And to all those that are worshiping with us, I thank God for you and I appreciate you. Our text this morning is coming from the Gospel according to Mark, chapter 1, verses 12 and 13 from the NRSV, as well as the Message paraphrase for our youth. It's a customary thing that I do at the church, and I want to continue doing it right now. And it reads as thus on the NRSV. And the Spirit immediately drove him out into the wilderness. He was in the wilderness 40 days, tempted by Satan. And he was with the wild beast, and the angels waited on him. From the Message paraphrase, according to Mark, at once the Spirit pushed Jesus out into the wild. For 40 wilderness days and nights he was tested by Satan. Wild animals were his companions, and the angels took care of him. I'd like to entitle this message today for you all, The Danger Zone. While reading one of Walter Brueggemann's book about Lent, I found the ending of a caption that he said of one of the particular days that we all enter the danger zone. The danger zone is an area where there is a high risk of harm, especially with the risk that has been officially being identified. The danger zone is a situation that is hazardous or controversial. There's a danger zone where any one of us who can step on a metaphorical landmine, and there are all kinds of issues in the desert that take us to risk, that challenge us and cause us to be our best. We don't have to see the desert as a bad place. Every child of God must go through testing and find out how mature they are to be assured of their calling and to know where God wants to take them. The desert is not some unusual place, or the wilderness is not some unusual place that God uses to take his people. It's a place where God uses that area for us to mature and grow and be the people that he's looking for. He wants us to grow in maturity and in faith and get to know him. How are you going to get to know God if you don't run into any difficulties or opposition, or if you're not tested or tried? How are you going to know how strong you are until you have to run up against something where you have to use your strength and your abilities, whether it be mental agility or physical physique and strength and power of your own body? How are you going to know if you can handle Satan or the evils or the wiles of the devil, as is written by some, unless you're able to deal with him spiritually? This is no game for amateurs. This is what every child of God must go through. And it was a physical desert that Jesus went through, but I'm going to speak both metaphorically this morning with you, as well as with the context of the message from Mark is saying. Now this text is copied or spoken of in the other synoptic gospels of Luke and Matthew. Both leave a long story and inside of what they're going through. But Mark gives us a shorter version. He's quick to the point about what's going on. He doesn't give you a litany or about the birth process, or who's some kin to who, and how this royal lineage takes place. Mark goes right to the heart of the matter. He writes in such an immediate way, in such a hurry. He hits the nail right on the head and saying that after Jesus' baptism, the Holy Spirit ushered him or led him into the wilderness with a sense of urgency to understand that his task is far greater than he humanly can understand. He had to meet and grow up and go there to prepare for what he was going to endeavor on a daily basis. For 30 years, he'd walked along. He'd been treated like a Jew, and that's not real good. He was born in a difficult place, raised inside a ghetto called Nazareth. But yet he never let any of those things hold him down. At 12, he was found in the temple, which was going to manhood, teaching about the Lord and his word. People were astonished at his abilities. Now comes the calling of God. Now comes a time when God said, it's time to step out. It's time to step up. It's time for people to see you and know what my message and purpose is for your divine life. And it's there that after the baptism of the presence of the Father and the Holy Ghost and John the Baptist and witnesses of the people, that he descends as a dove descends upon him, lets him know he of that same power and presence drives him out to some obscure, dry, hazardous place. The desert, full of rocks and barrenness, full of animals that call and crave on one another, that prey upon one another, that eat one another. The creepy crawly things like snakes and camel spiders and pit vipers. Wherever you step, you got to be careful. If you don't know, the sand is shifting, and it's difficult to be around sometimes. The sand can be both friend and foe. The wind can be both friend and foe as well. The sounds in the day and the night, the time that Jesus spent there, those elements of the earth and of nature would be both a friend and foe of Jesus, because the wind would blow one day and to wipe the sweat off the brow from the heat of the day while walking out there in preparation to deal with an adversary who is no mere mortal. He's no one to play with. He's been there a long time doing what he's doing. No human being can defeat him without the power of God. He's good at what he does. He's got many nicknames: adversary, Satan, evil, slewfoot, the liar, anything you want to call him. He opposes God on everything, and what he can do now, he sees that God has become incarnate and the God-man, and says, now I have you. You won't use your power, your godly power, to get out of this, but now you have to confront me. You're going to see what humans go through and how I take the best out of them. I've beat them all. I beat Abraham. I beat Solomon. I beat Moses. I beat Elijah. I beat them all down. They all came. They all went running. They all were afraid. And they're walking the same trail you have. You were on the road. You're going to be out here for a long time, and so were they. They were on a journey to escape. They were on a journey to lead people out. But along the way, I made them mad. Along the way, I got them upset. Along the way, I gave them depression. On the way, I made them feel like they were the only ones left in the world, that they were shouldering the responsibilities that nobody else could shoulder. I made them think that they were the one, and I'll get you too. You're in my zone now. You're in the place where I determine whether you're going to make it or not. And right now, my score is, my wins are always perfect. There is zero against me. So when I get you, I'll show God who I really am. I'm not only the prince of the air. I am the one who's going to take control. I know cunningness. I know craftiness. I know the word of God. I know what is there. I sung one of the greatest. I was one of the greatest singers of all time. And now I've been exiled because I had ambition and wanted to be something, because I thought God was too slow. I thought God wasn't what he should have been. I think there needed to be a better leader in heaven. And though I was struck down and fell like a lightning bolt falling from the sky, my goal is to destroy anything that's his. Anybody that believes in him, anybody that even gets close to him, I will utterly destroy them. I will attack them with every means in my arsenal. I will bring out weapons they never heard of. Not all are bad. Some of them look good. Some of them sound good. Some of them taste good. But that's not the interest I have for them. My ultimate goal is to destroy their character and ultimately destroy them. This is what Jesus is getting ready to go into. And as we prepare for that, God wants every child of God to know that when you trust him and obey him, you go into areas like this every day of your life so that you can meet the challenges that make you the best you can be, that bring out the maximum potentiality of your powers that he has blessed you with, and you begin to sharpen your skills and hone your relationship and embrace it and solidify it with God through your challenges, through the difficulties that the world will throw at you. Why? Because you're not alone in your journey. You have the presence of the Holy Spirit and the angels to comfort you, to aid you, to strengthen you, and to pour back into you what you pour out. Because in that desert, you're not alone. In that desert, though it looked like an austere, dry, barren, ugly place, it feels unsafe. You don't know what's going to come out, whether bandits or whether beasts. You don't know whether it's going to come out, whether it's going to rain or be a sandstorm or a hot, blistering day. It will cause delusions. It will cause confusion. It will make you think that you have an oasis when you really have nothing. It will give you mirages, and it will mess your mind up. It will cause you to have conflict. It will cause you to doubt yourself. It will cause you to doubt your theology. It will cause you to wonder if your faith is strong enough. That's what this place is for. It will tell you where your friends are and family are few and in between. It will tell you how faithful they are, how loving they are. You will meet hate, chaos, injustice. You will meet a barrage and parade of issues that you never expected. Some you know, and some you're going to grow from. And that's what's going on in our lesson today. That's what's going on in the text today. As Jesus is confronted with evil and driven by the Spirit that escorts him out there, not against Jesus' will, but to take him out there for the importance to know the task at hand is about the salvation of souls. And he's got to be tested to know what he's going to deal with every day in human form. He is the God-man. He is to struggle with what's going on. He is to make a difference in the world. And the only way he's going to do that is to live like we live. And he did just that. He dealt with evil daily. And this is the beginning of Lent, and I want to read something from Walter Brueggemann, where I took the title from reading from him, as I said earlier. It says this, Lent recalls times of wilderness and wandering, when newly freed slaves in the exile to Jesus' temptation in the desert. God has always called people out of their safe walled cities into uncomfortable places, revealing paths that would never even have chosen. Despite our culture of self-indulgence, we too are called to walk an alternative path, one of humility, justice, and peace. Lent is a time for learning how to listen to the voices and promises, the voice of a promise and the voice of seduction, and decide how to adjudicate either of them. To hear better the true voice of assurance, and to notice quickly the deceptive voice of the unfaith. And to distinguish the same psalm, when it speaks faith and when it serves in unfaith. It will be a gain for us to see our Lent as placing between us a conflicting voices. Christian society casts exactly between the voices, deciding if they have the faith that seeks understanding, or if our learning is simply a power pack as knowledge. Christians in our society are cast between the voices in the terms of political and economic power to see whether we have honored the pain-filled voices of marginality, or if we will notice only the tired claim of the old monopolies. Christians in our society are cast between the voices in terms of self-identity, to see if we can receive the innocence of the real faith or if we practice the same old cynical despair, which works most of the time. We're at risk because the assurances of God can be turned against ourselves to a warrant of cheap self-serving actions. We begin our Lenten journey addressing by a remarkable assurance that God who summons us is the God who walks along with us. We begin our journey, we will want to ease off and not take risk. We will have challenges, and we will make it. We will go through it as we ought to. Challenges of economically in terms of self-profession, to make decisions, hearing more than one inviting voice. The world thinks the journey is unimportant, and therefore easy. Well, yes, as Brueggemann says, the world may think it's easy because it is the only faith that requires entering the danger zone where our lives are at risk. Mark emphasizes that story as he deals with Jesus in a fast pace about his coming of age and of his calling and acceptance of God. He has to go to that place that we discussed earlier. Mark emphasizes the close connection between the baptism and the temptation by Jesus in the use of characteristics of at once the Spirit ushered him. And Jesus didn't go, as I said earlier, because he was forced to, but he went to go because he would follow the Spirit. went there for 40 days and so forth. But let us get into the text, as I want you to know today, and as we get closer into it, the new normal, the danger zone, the wilderness. The Holy Spirit takes all believers through this experience more often than one knows. It is where we learn to trust in God, find our power and faith firm's footing, discerning the voices and relishing in our calling and being molded and shaped into the person that God has called us to be. It is not the only time we'll encounter it. The desert is a lifelong process until God calls us home, until we relinquish this flesh and get up into our places in eternality. We're children of two worlds, one of time and one of eternality. But as long as we're in time, we're always in the wilderness of school. We're always learning something, because our adversary doesn't take vacations. Our adversary is always prowling and roaming and seeing who he may devour. He's busy. But the child of God needs to know that you're never alone in this journey. Once you accept Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, you're about to endure with the unthinkable. You're about to endure the unimaginable. You're about to handle situations that you didn't think you could because of the presence and the power that dwells within you. It may look like you're alone. It may feel like you're alone. The circumstances that are presented to you seem like they're overwhelming to you. However, God is with you. God will never take you places that he won't be with you. And as I've said before, if God brings you to it, God's going to take you through it. And that's our lives every day in this. There may be somebody out there today who may not understand this, and who's going through challenges and just don't know why they're going through these difficulties and feel so defeated, feel so hurt, feel so alone, and feel so isolated and left on the edge of society, seeming like nobody cares. They've been labeled. They've been talked about. They've been scandalized. They've been marginalized. They've been pushed down. Every time they've got the job, every time they've got the education, you're too smart, you're overqualified, you're underqualified. Always some excuse on why you can't succeed. You're in the desert. When they tell you you don't look right, they don't like the style of clothes you wear or how you wear your hair, you're in the desert. When they tell you, well, you ought to be happy just to have the job, you're in the desert. It doesn't have to come from a particular color of people. It can come from your own folk. Because even the evil doesn't discriminate. It attacks from within and wherever. If you're succeeding in a family, we should uphold one another. But the family just does not extend to those you're born with, but the family you're born into, the divine family. Because all of us become brothers and sisters in Christ when the blood of Christ covers us. And when we accept Christ as our personal Lord and Savior, we're no longer the same people. There's something that God has for us. And therefore, we must help one another as we would any other situation, because now you're my blood brother and sister by the power and grace and mercy of God. He has took away all our sins and made us one. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. So anybody that walks into our places of worship or into the places of worship of God, or anyone that walks the streets and claims the title of being a Christian or a child of God, anyone who professes to be something and yet don't live it, check yourself. It's here that the lesson is trying to teach us that you're going to have to go through these things and you're going to find out how strong you really are. Are you really just a professor? Are you a practitioner of God's truth? Are you phony? Are you faithful? Are you fickle? Are you hypersensitive to God? Are you just a hypocrite? These are the places where you're going to learn who you are. You're going to learn how scared you are of some things. You're going to learn about your phobias. You're going to learn about your faith. You're going to learn about how good God is. You're going to recognize God in different ways. So if you're out there listening today and some of those things speak to you, I'm encouraging you to listen even closer, because God has something special for you today. God wants you to know he loves you beyond a shadow of a doubt. And that these troubles, they don't last always. These difficulties, they're going to make you stronger. These hardships, they're going to show you how strong God really is. And when the mountain is in your way and it seems unclimbable, or you just can't tunnel through, God specializes in things that seem impossible. It is here that Mark lets us know that the Spirit rushes Jesus into this obscure and dangerous area where others have traveled before him. Moses, taking the people from slavery to freedom. Freedom often scares us because we don't have somebody to tell us what to do or how to do it. Freedom gives us that expression to really worship God, not in some sort of form that we have to by the taskmasters of our time, the clock, but it tells us we can worship God anywhere we want to. We can learn to love him anywhere we want to. We can praise our God in our car. We can praise our God in the meditational moments in between our breaks at our jobs. We can praise our God by just looking out at the majesty and beauty of his creation. Looking at the ocean and knowing that it will roll in only so far and will obey the command of God to be still and come no further. It will see the creations of God's fish and his animals and the birds in the air and see the beauty of a sunset and a sunrise and know that there's a God in heaven. To feel the whistling wind that sometime is our friend and blow across us the sea spray of time that reminds us of how fresh it is and how wonderful it is and the benefits that it gives to us. The sunshine that beams down its warmth upon us, we will know that's God. But in this terrible place, you have all those elements. You have good and bad. You have difficulty and sad. You have midnight moments. You have moments of despair. You have moments of seemingly hopelessness. You have moments where you don't know what's going to happen. But here I'm here to confirm to you today by the word of the Lord that you are not alone. The Lord, the Spirit is with you. Jesus is with you. And the angels are with you to provide everything you need and everything that's going to help you be the person that you need to be. Let's take a close look at the people that the Jesus company that he had. Not only did he have the presence of the Holy Spirit, this third person of God, as we speak in our first article, you know, for those, our second article, of those who are in, those who are going through catechism, or preparing for catechism, that God is all three in one, yet the same. It is the Holy Spirit that is there, that is with him, counseling him and encouraging him and empowering him as he does with us every day. Nothing was slack, no tricks, no nothing up God's sleeve. God was just honestly showing us how much he loves us as he loves his son, Jesus Christ. He showed us that the Spirit is with us. And the Spirit has the power. He's the gift giver. He's the one that calls us to our callings and gives us the equipment and the abilities to do what needs to be done. He encourages us. He warns us. He tells us to stay away from certain things and don't go this way. He pricks our conscience. He gives us peace that surpasseth all understanding. He gives us the fruits of the Spirit. And he gives us power to fight Satan. Because the power of his presence is a turnoff to Satan. Because Satan can't defeat God. And Satan knows that. He just don't want you to know the secret and the power that you have within you is the presence of God's Spirit. And then he has angels, divine people or beings that come by to assure you and to comfort you and to meet your needs. Angels are friends all the time. In the desert, Jesus had angels. I don't know what they looked like, what they sounded like, but they had a purpose. Today in our time, in our deserts, they're friends. They often don't say much, but they're there for you. They'll send you an encouraging note or a text, or they'll do a Snapchat. Some way they will let you know that you're not alone in this journey. They will see you struggling. They will offer you bread. They will offer you water. They will do their best to take care of you. And sometimes when you're at a loss for words and don't know where you're at or what you're going through, their presence says it all. They don't have to say anything, but their presence of being there says it, says, speaks volumes of words that all the words that verbally could be spoken. They make a difference in your life because they're there with you. And then there was the creatures that were there, the animals, as Mark writes. They were Jesus' company. Whether they were predators or prey, doesn't matter, they were there. Listen to them in the day and the night where they kept silent and they were on the hunt, sniffing their way through in the daylight, because most of them tried to stay out of the sun because of the blistering heat that would come down and heat the ground. The snakes would hide in shadowed areas because they were cold-blooded, but it was just too hot out there for them. Sometimes they would lay on a rock, but they wanted to be hid because the prey from above with wings, it would come down and take them, and they would be dinner. All the camel spiders, of all those little creepy, crawly pit vipers that would slither and hide in places not to be seen, to wait and allure for their dinner to come to them. Maybe it was just animals that knew something, and they were just around the perimeter of him. But he heard these voices. He heard these sounds. And then at night when the wind would blow, it seemed like something is close to you, when it's just rustling leaves or a tumbleweed rolling around the area, or something distant. That sand and that wind could be both friend and foe, because the wind could be there to cool you off and cool your body temperature down, or it could also be a blistering sharp instrument that stripped your clothes down to the bone. It could blow with such force and wind that it obscured your vision, that it took your body and just sandblasted it, that what was exposed. But the wind was there, howling like a dog at night, howling with the other animals, competing with the animals out there and still making a louder noise. You knew its presence, you knew its power, but Jesus still went through it. He looked at the wind. Yeah, I see you. He endured it. He covered himself, took his cloak and covered him so he wouldn't do nothing. It wouldn't hurt him or damage him. He watched where he stepped because he knew what his environment was about, because he grew up in that area. He learned some things before, and he had power to deal with it and strength to deal with it. And there those animals were there waiting and looking and sounding and watching. And that was a company that he kept. We don't know whether there are predators out there. We got predators every day in our lives trying to take our homes, trying to fool our people, trying to do everything they can to the aged and to all of us. Scammers and everyone else trying to be predators upon one another. There are predators in the church. There are predators on our jobs. Everyone's trying to hurt somebody and do harm to somebody. But don't worry, God is with you. And with being in the desert, this, we're asking God to give us clarity so we can see, to give us discerning eyes and ears and a heart to know which voice is real and which voice isn't, who is both prayerful and a practitioner of your truth, and who are the predators and the phonies that are in life, so we can see them and give us the strength and power and the gifts and the fruit to deal with them accordingly. Not to damn them to hell, but win that foe to a friend and show them that the power of God can transform anybody and everybody who's willing. The animals were there. They were looking around, the birds of the air, all sorts of animals around the place, nurturing our Lord and being company to him, but yet keeping their distance from him. And it seemed like they were out there and Jesus was with them, and Jesus let them know that he was not afraid or fearful. He heard them. He saw them midnight when things didn't look good. But time was a factor for Jesus. He spent a lot of time there, and that alluring presence that was out there. It's not the wind. It wasn't the sand. It wasn't the sun. It wasn't the beast that he needed to worry about, or the carnivorous animals, or the deadly snakes, or the spiders, all those things. He had someone he had to confront, who'd been doing this for an age-long time. He'd been doing this so well and so good, his record was perfect. He had destroyed just about everybody. Somebody had tripped and fallen because of him. He'd stripped them and damaged their witness. And when you damage somebody's witness, all it seems as though people will remember is the bad you did and never the good that God is doing with you. 1 ounce of badness and a whole 3,000 tons of goodness, and all they see is that speck instead of the mountain of good God has done in your life. That's how Satan preys on you and said, you ain't all that. But God says, yes, you are. I took what you made as a mistake, and look what I've done with it. I saw the difficulty that you went through, but look where you are now. I saw how low you was, and look how I elevated you. That's what God does. It is in the desert that you confront yourself and you confront what's going on in your life, your mixed emotions, your faith is tried, and you don't know because you hear all these voices, and it's here where God is going to make a defining moment where you hear his voice over this other subtle voice. And this is here where Jesus is waiting. And when Jesus is hungry, and Jesus is probably a little weary from the walk and the days that he spent out there, he's probably tired now, probably a little thirsty, but more so he's hungry. And this is where Satan waits. This is where evil waits. He waits for the most opportune time to attack you. And this is what he done with Jesus. He waited for the opportune moment to attack Jesus when he thought he was hungry. And he came at him saying this, "Hello. So, you come to my territory now and you think you're really ready for me?" Forgive my paraphrase. And he's sitting there and he says, "If you be the Son of God," some authoritative voice and then some voice of seduction, "If you be the Son of God," trying to catch Jesus with his ego. "What you mean, if? I know I am." He's trying to catch Jesus, pull us away from by attaching us and attacking us where we think we're strong and I got this. No, God's got you. "If you be the Son of God." You see these stones here? They look delicious, don't they? Don't they remind you of that pita bread? Don't they remind you of that bread made in a rush when the slaves got out of Egypt? They didn't even have time to let it rise. But oh, I bet that would taste good right now. "If you be the Son of God." You know what the power to just say, make something out of nothing. Ex nihilo. Just speak and it just shows up. "If you be the Son of God," who is supposed to be ready to come and do all these miracles and save all these people. "If you be the power, the God-man himself, who picked his own mama and walked down 40 and two generations and lived in this dusty time for 30 years, being treated and raised in the ghetto. If you be the Son of God, if you got the power you think you have, if you think you're the person you're supposed to be, turn these stones into bread." Notice how Satan attacks when he thinks we're vulnerable, when he thinks that we don't have the ability to handle him. But what he didn't know, that while Jesus was walking in the desert, he was also walking with the Lord. While he was walking in the desert in the day and night, he had time with the Spirit to tell him that he's going to come. And when he comes, he's coming for the jugular. He's going to try to cut you. He's going to try to hurt you. He's going to try to wound you. He's going to attack you through your physical body. He's going to attack you because he thinks your mind can't handle the situation. He's going to attack you because he knows that your body has needs too. He knows that your mind has needs. And that's where he's going to attack you. He's going to wait you out. And now the time has come and Jesus is faced with him. And the first test is about something to eat. And Jesus answered that, "For time's sake, I'll keep it short." And Jesus looks at him and said, "Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God." Jesus is talking about not this bread that you got to eat every day. Jesus is talking about soul satisfaction. Something that's good for you every day that you can feast on. Something that's there for you that works from the inside out. That empowers you to know what's good and what's not good. That looked like bread. And the way he made it seem and the picture he drew in Jesus' mind and in our mind today, my God, if we had the ability, some of us would turn that stone into bread because we're hungry. But Jesus looked at it for what it was. It was a trick. It was a deceptive ploy to get Jesus to prove or to disprove Jesus' power and ability. If you're all powerful, you wouldn't have let me fool you. If you're all powerful, you wouldn't have obeyed me. If you're all powerful, you wouldn't have let me put you in this position to do this. But Jesus caught him. Jesus caught him where he was because he'd been in that desert long enough, not wasting time, but worshiping God. While you're in your desert experiences and you're going through the problems that you're going through, give God some praise and worship him. Remember the script, the Holy Writ of God. Be mindful that, lo, I'm with you. Or like the psalmist said, where can I go to get away from your presence? Wherever you are, that's wherever I go, that's where you are. I'll be like David. He told, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not lack. And he prepareth the table before me in the presence of mine enemies, as my great friend, the Reverend Dr. Lee Edward Field, said. You got to get some more enemies, because God preparing a banquet before you in front of them. That's where he is. And he beat Satan at that time. So Satan tries another one. Takes him around, says, look, here this is. The word says, high pinnacle, highest place, the holy place. He has the audacity to step into the holy place. It lets us know Satan comes to our worship centers too. And sometimes he's dressed up in a three-piece suit. Sometimes he's dressed up in a pastor's robe. Sometimes he sits on the deacon board and the trustees and on the mothers. Sometimes he sings in the choir. Sometimes he ushers. Sometimes he sits in the pew plotting how to destroy you. Comes with an attitude. Their purpose and intent is not to harm anybody initially, but he plants something in them. Who does he think, or who does she think she is? Coming in here with a robe on. Who do they think they are? They're God's chosen. And the question you ought to be asking is why God didn't choose you. What made you lack something that God skipped over you? Maybe it's your heart. Maybe it's your attitude. Maybe it's your frame of mind. Maybe because you don't have faith at all. That's why the desert is beating you to death. But God hasn't taken you out of it. He's keeping you in it so he can get closer to you. You're going to eventually find out that you need him more than he needs you. He's challenging you to be a better person, dealing with it. And the people like Jesus set an example to let us know that we're not to hate or destroy. We're to love the hell out of you. We're to set an example on how good God is, because if he can help us through it, he will definitely help you through it too. It was there that Jesus was there and Satan tried to tag him and said, jump, according to the word. Now this boy is cunning. According to the word, if you just jump. The Hebrew hymnal in the psalm says that if you jump, the angels will catch you. They won't let your foot hit a stone. They'll protect you. Jesus had to remind him who he was. God has all power. He took him to a place and said, all this, showed him all the kingdoms of the world and showed him all it to him. They look. If you just bow down and worship me, thou shalt not tempt the Lord thy God. Told him another time, you don't own anything. It's not yours to give. God is sovereign. God owns all of this. The universe is his. He's the one that stepped out on nothing and said something. And with the blink of an eye, quicker than just then, let there be light. And boom, light showed up. Out of chaos and out of inactivity became life and creation. Jesus reminded them, you don't really have no power. You're just walking around just full of nothingness and full of tricks and got a bag of phoniness with you. But the real power is the Lord our God. God is sovereign and God will do great things with us and through us if we trust him. Mark writes to remind our people about these wilderness experiences and the dangers of the animals because they were going through persecution as he wrote this letter. And it must, that must have been something for them to realize that Jesus was going through the desert, as the story is, that he went out there where they were and he made it through. It doesn't mean that you're not going to get to heaven without scars or bruises or pain or suffering. What it does tell us is that we're going to have issues that are going to take the best of us at times. They're going to hurt us. We're going to have friends that are fickle and family members that desert us and religious folk that act irreligious. This is what he is. Satan, Slewfoot, whatever you want to call him, is the one that will challenge our faith in God and test our strength through our bodies. His voice is alluring, captivating, and dangerous. He's old and as skilled at his craft, and we are no match for him alone. But here's what Jesus had that made the uniqueness as our heritage to a close. The Spirit and the angels were with him, encouraging him and caring and empowering him as he confronts the adversary. He can beat him because of his relationship with God. He defeated him because of his love, and his motivation in his heart was to serve God with his whole being and his power as a human and as God. He loved God and gave his best to him. The power that he possessed defeated Satan because Satan has no power over God. Satan is weak and impotent when it comes to him. At the word, at the authority of God's word, Satan has to flee. Even demons know better. When they saw Jesus, "Why have you come to torture us now?" He told them to be silent. Even demons recognize righteousness, holiness, and power. Though weary and tired, and though dealing with the daily seen and unseen, the animals' winds blow as both friend and foe, he defeated his foe with hunger, but with the word of the Lord, which is soul satisfying. He defeated him, defeated his foe by reminding him that God is the owner, that God, and that God is not to be tested by someone who has no power or arms that are big enough to box with him. He defeated his foe, Satan, revealing that God is sovereign. However, in the text, there's something important you need to remember, especially in Luke's translation from Luke's gospel. He says this: the deceiver stopped when he found out he could not defeat Jesus, and he turned and walked away. But Luke tells us he left Jesus until a more opportune time. While we're in these bodies, we cannot escape the fact that Satan or evil will always be after us. You may have fair days where the sun is shining, where there's no pain, your money is in the bank, but things are going well, then there comes a day when it seemed like the bottom has fallen out, torrential storms have come, seemed like your sun has been eclipsed by issues of the day, seemed like hatred has risen on every hand, seemed like problems are insurmountable. But you hold tight, because you're never alone. We're never alone. We are the first, nor will we be the last to enter the danger zone. We must be studious to defeat the evil one. We must put on our powers and our armor of prayer and faith and carry the sword of God's word and put into practice what we believe, think, and live every day. The world must see it as a reality, not just people being pious, but people who are being productive. Do not go beyond your calling. It's dangerous to do something that God hasn't called you to do. Jesus was taught with the Spirit, and given those challenges that Satan waited for the day, he was prepared. You too must be prepared. You too must study God's word. You too must meditate on him day and night. You too must give up something and give God some time so that you can be closer to him and make a difference and impact in the world. But here's a danger. If you're going out there to mess with a tiger and you're going to grab it by the tail, make sure you're trained and skilled and equipped to handle the tiger by the tail. Because when the tiger turns on you and you don't have a whip and you don't know how to handle that tiger, you may be mauled, you may be bitten, you may be scratched, you may be injured, you may be crippled because you don't know what you're doing. You remember Paul in the sermon in Acts, where the man comes in because he's seen what the power of the disciples were doing, and he went into the demon-possessed man. And he was trying to tell them, you need to come out in the name of Jesus. And the demon said, now, wait a minute. Now, I know Peter now. I know Paul, but who are you? And then he commenced to whooping him out of his clothes, beat him unmercifully, and sent him running into the streets. Took his clothes, stripped him, and showed just what he was, a man empty of substance, and let him walk out and something. You professing something and trying to handle powers you know nothing of, but even the demon knew you ain't got nothing. But I'm gonna make an example out of you. I'm gonna beat you today. And he whipped him out of his clothes. Don't try to handle something you're not capable of and you didn't get the calling. Too many pretenders in the pulpit today trying to proclaim a gospel that they don't know anything about. giving half-truths and watered-down gospel messages that don't really impact people's lives, trying to make people happy instead of trying to tell them that the soul that sinneth, it shall die. People need to hear truth from God. They need to know that God is with them. They need to hear good news, that despite you going through this, despite this, it ain't all prosperity. It's prosperity on the inside, not on what you acquire on the outside. That don't get you to heaven. It's what you do for the Lord and the motives that you do it for. That's how you make it through the desert. That's how it comes through. That's how God made it. Jesus was our example of how you turn a desert into an oasis. Not just when we die are we going to see the greatness, but we're going to experience the oasis that is not a mirage. It is a materialistic thing that God has showed us that we experience on the inside, and that God empowers us to handle our issues. We feel the refreshing wind of the Spirit. We have the water gushing up from inside of us because it's spiritual nourishment. We have manna from heaven, the word of God, the shield of faith. We are ready because God is empowering us every day to deal with the difficulties. We look weary. We look tired. And some of us are. Some of us go through those things. Some of us feel like the world has turned against us. Some of us feel like Elijah, like we're the only one left. Some of us feel like Moses. We're wondering whether we got a bunch of sheep or whether we got a herd or a zoo. We don't know what's going on. But one thing we got to realize, God didn't call us to judge his people. God didn't call us to talk about them or call them out of their name. God called us to servant lead them. Be the example. Show them how to do it. Get out there and make a difference. So if you're sitting on yourself, if you're sitting there thinking you're doing something and ain't done nothing for your community, if your church is involved, if your church and congregation have the ability to have an impact in your community, that's what you should be doing. When I was hungry, you fed me. When I was thirsty, you gave me something to drink. When I was naked, you put clothes on my back. When I was sick and in prison, you came by to visit me. When I was lonely, you showed up. You make a difference. That's what Jesus is looking for. Lord, when did we see you like this? On your journey in the desert, you will find that when you see a need, you'll meet a need. Why? Because the more you pour out of yourself, the more the Holy Spirit pours back into yourself so that you'll have something greater to give. See, as space empties out of you, as the Spirit is water-like going through that cut through the rocks of time, it takes time for them to wedge and create a canal or to make the mountains and reshape them. Little by little is doing it. The more you do, you empty out, the more God pours back into you. The more you pour out, the more it keeps pushing in. And it's transforming you and changing you from the inside out. Your motive center changes and you begin to find the love of God in your life. And you learn how to love other people. And even though you walk through the valley of the shadow of death, you will fear no evil, for thou art with me. His rod and his staff, it comforts me. You know goodness and mercy shall follow you all the days of your life. You will not fear that. You will stand by that truth. It will hold you in the midnight hour. Weeping may endure for the night. Cries and tears of rivers and even tears of an ocean stream down your face, making a canal down the cheeks of your face. But just hold on in the morning. And morning don't have to mean when the sun rises above the eastern hemisphere. Morning starts in the midnight. Morning starts at night. In the morning, joy comes. You'll recognize God when you see God in that midst and in the potential of what you're doing. You'll be still and know that God, hey, I'm not alone. I'm not by myself. God is with me. And we have something to know. That's how Jesus defeated it. That's how he turned that midnight into daylight. That's how he turned that mirage into an oasis. That's how he turned the desert into a training ground, because God had used it also before with the Hebrew children and Moses and with Elijah and others that have been through it. God, even John the Baptist, chose the desert to bring the people out there to get them away from the busyness of the city and the temptations and the lures of the lights and the big nights and the people and the hanging out and all of that, so they could get close to God. And when you got to withdraw some time to advance, someone said, you got to get out there with God. Spend time with God, recognize God, praise God, worship God, and understand Him, and ask God to reveal what your calling is. Jesus' example of how a desert turns into the oasis is powerful now. The power of His presence is the answer to evil. To dismiss and dismantle, disarm evil with love, to show mercy and to do justly, to gain courage even when you are wounded, battered, and bruised. Still we rise because of the ever-flowing waters of life that gush up from the inside. Even if we can't run, as Dr. King said, walk. And even if you can't walk, crawl. But we're going to get to the promised land. Keep doing what you're doing. He defeated him temporarily because while we live in this earth, He is relentless to destroy us. But greater is He that is in us. Underline this in the text. Greater is He that is in us than he that is in the world. Underline this in your word. Underline and know this for yourself. Not in today's text, but underline it because it's in the biblical text. Greater is God and Christ and the Holy Ghost that is in us than he, Satan, that is in the world. He, evildoer, he, slewfoot. Whatever you want to call that trickster, whatever you want to call that bag of tricks, whatever you want to call him, greater is he that is in us than he that is in the world. Christ has set us an example, and we call upon him and ask him to show us what's required of us. So if you don't know Christ today, come to know Christ in a special way. Jesus showed us how to make it through the danger zone and how that place can become a place not only of danger, but how it can produce the best out of all of us. It can become a learning place, a place where he can show us how to strengthen our faith and our trust and our obedience and to practice what God wants from us daily as we're challenged by the evil one on a daily basis. Satan is not going to give up. He's not going to give in, but he is going to come after you every day of your life. And we challenge you that if you don't know Christ, to come and ask God to come into your life right now and ask him to bless you and keep you and strengthen you in all your ways. Say, Lord, please come into my life. Forgive me for my transgressions. I repent of all my sins. I don't know all that I did because I'm not that familiar with you. But something was said today, something was prayed, some song that was sung touched my heart in a way that's never been touched before. It made me see things that I never saw before. So I'm asking you to move upon me right now and bless me with the power that I need to be transformed and become a disciple of yours, a disciplined believer. Therefore, I accept Christ as my personal Lord and Savior and mean it, not just words. These aren't magical words. It has to be from you, from the motive center of your heart to where you want a real change in your life. And God will change you. Then I encourage you to find some place of worship where you can learn and grow to be a disciple of Christ as a disciplined believer, one who practices those things so that when you're in this desert, you can fight off Satan with the word of God, with the shield of faith, with the sword of God's holy word, and with the presence and power of the Holy Spirit who prepares you to go to the next level or the next place that God wants you to go because God has given you something. It may seem small and insignificant right now, but every piece of the puzzle is important to make the whole puzzle fit and make it whole. If you're faithful in the small things, God will bless you in the big things. So that's my challenge for you today. Accept Christ as your personal Lord and Savior. And let's just pray. Eternal God, we ask you to bless those who have heard your word today and who've been challenged by the text. They've been convicted knowing that they're in a wilderness experience and it's dangerous. They're fighting odds and facing foes they've never met before, whether it's drug addictions or alcoholism, whether it's sexism or traffic in any kind of way, whether they're problems with family and friends, where people just don't like them because they don't like them. But Lord, we know that you're a friend to the friendless, that you love us in spite of, that there's no depth that you won't go to bring us out of our difficulties, that you take us from the muck and mire of life, that we may have gotten our own selves into by our own choices or from the pig pens of life and make us come to ourselves and realize that we have it better with you. And if they're thinking that, God, forgive them, restore them, accept them in, continue to convince them, have that relationship with them that broadens their depths and brings them closer to you. This we pray and give thanks, and for your salvation, your grace, and mercy. In Christ's name, amen. And to our visiting friends, we want to thank you for your continued blessings and support to our worship and to our ministry here at Best Grove. We still ask you to send in your tithes and offerings, and if you want to make a donation to us, we greatly appreciate it. We're a church that's constantly busy. We fed over 500 people the other day for the soul food on base, and we thank God for that, for our servicemen and women. We just love doing it, Best Grove. I'm humbled and honored to serve people who've been doing it a long time. They've been in existence a long time. And service before self, above self, and excellence in all that they do. All those things that we were taught about and all the things I learned in the military, God was already working it with them. So I thank God for them and their love that they continue to show to our community, whether it's feeding, providing clothes, saying hello, visiting, calling, or touching people that they don't know to make a difference in their lives. I thank God for them, and I'm humbled to be their pastor. So if you want to do something to help us, please send your contributions to Post Office Box 10726, Goldsboro, North Carolina 27530. Or you can go by our office at 1065 Tommy's Road, Goldsboro, North Carolina 27534. And drop off your donations and contributions and tithes there. You can call first at 919-735-2274. And lastly, you can go on our website at bestgrovechurch.org and go to the menu and find giving and do online giving to us. It's very safe and secure, so you can give to us. And lastly, a few memos to let you know that on March 6th, from 9 to 2 p.m., 9 a.m. to 2 p.m., they're going to be giving vaccinations for the COVID at Bear Creek Missionary Baptist Association at 1800 South Slocum Street. We're working in conjunction with Goshen and with the moderator from Fayetteville. And we want to thank him for his sharing that. He's the fourth vice president of the General Baptist State Convention. And I want to thank him for that, for thinking of us and helping us to get in touch with Goshen. His name eludes me. Forgive me, Pastor. Give me moderator. But we're going to be giving shots. It's Moderna. And what they're going to do is set up for 65 and older, also those that are teaching, and also those that have underlying conditions as diabetes, heart, whether you're a smoker. So anybody that needs it, you just need to call 919-735-2274 and leave us your name and your number. And also you can email at Helen C. Harris, HelenCharris, at ncnancycharlie.rr.com. Email her that information and we'll make sure we put you on the list. We're going to go to the end of the month collecting names so that we can make sure we get the amount of proper amount of serum for those people that selected. We're doing it for all our community, our Hispanic community, our brothers and sisters, to our Haitian brothers and sisters, to all in our community of all colors and stripes. It doesn't matter to us. We just want to meet a need. But especially to our teachers and those who are going to work, to those frontline workers, we need you. We thank you. And those who are going through it that need it, our seniors that need those shots and choose to do so, it's there for you. We love you and we ask that God continue to bless you and keep you. I end with the song and ask God to bless you as we prepare to depart today. So we love you. And God bless you.
These were so plentiful in our past. You know, the black men and black women got on slave ships together. We laid down in the filthy hatches together. We stood up later together on auction blocks together. We got up before sunrise and slept after sunset together. It was always together. We have to look at that very seriously these days, to wonder why aren't we together. Now, these days we have acoustic guitars and pianos. We have all sorts of modern electric this and that. But all the time, through all those centuries, we had incredible saints among us. And they sung us all the way out of slavery. And they have to be remembered. They sung some simple songs. They could have in their songs asked for shelter, because sometimes they had nothing over their heads. They could have asked for food, because they had nothing in their pots. They could have asked for clothes, because sometimes only rags covered their bones and their skin. And yet, what they asked for was very simple in their song. They thought it was the most important thing in the world. They asked, Lord, could I have a closer walk with thee? Lord, just a closer walk with thee.
Just a closer walk with thee. Lord Jesus.
God bless you and thank you for worshiping with us today. I'm a little lengthy, but I thank God for you and ask God to continue to bless you with growing grace in the knowledge and peace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, both now and forevermore. In Christ's name, amen. Jack and I love you, and you have a blessed and productive week. Got any questions, call us or email me at jacksonja_rev@yahoo.com, or you can email me at the office at jacksonja-rev@nc.rr.com. I'll call the office and Miss Harris will get in touch with me, or call one of the deacons and they will get in touch with me too. All right, we love you and God bless you, and may God meet all your needs this week. Though you travel through the wilderness, lo, I'm with you always, even until the end of time. God bless you.